Okay.
Cool. All right, you guys. I'm here to talk about my site impact and how the Doctor of Athletic Training program has had a positive effect on me, my clinical site, and those around me, and pretty much my experiences that I've gone through over the last 3 years. So, an introduction about myself. I got my bachelor's in athletic training at CSUN in 2010. I did my master's and got that in 2014. My first job out of the program was Viewpoint School, and I was there 2 years part-time. And then once I finished the coursework for my master's, I got promoted to full-time, and I've been there 5 years and I'm still currently there. I was also a part-time lecturer for the evaluation lecture and lab in the athletic training program at CSUN. So what we're going to talk about is how the DATs changed my clinical practice, what I've learned in the last 3 years, how I've grown as a clinician and researcher in athletic training, my philosophies and how they changed over time, new treatment interventions that I learned, and I'm going to explain a little things about that. I'm going to talk about patient-reported outcomes, and then I'm also going to talk about how I affected my site and those around me and how I plan to move forward post-DAT. Now, before we move on, something that why I joined the DAT is I actually haven't really learned anything new in athletic training after my bachelor's. So I did my master's and nothing of that actually helped me with athletic training. I got my feet wet in research, it was biomechanics, I put EMG electrodes on people and didn't help me become a better athletic trainer. It was the MS after my name and that's all it was really for. And I was lost. I wasn't a better clinician. I didn't learn anything new. My idea of continued education was just going to these seminars. There were, you know, 3, 4, 5 day seminars at the national, regional level. And I didn't really learn much at those either. Like, I got my continued education units enough to stay certified as an athletic trainer. But I was lucky if I learned anything new going to any of these things. Because how much can you really learn in a 1 hour presentation on ankle rehab? So, clinical site, Viewpoint, it's a private, independent, non-denominational school. It's K through 12. My primary responsibility is at the high school or upper school level. That's 9 through 12. My secondary responsibility is the PE, on-campus PE, on-campus athletic events for grades 4 through 8. So there's not a whole lot of incidents there, but the kids do get hurt and they do need stuff. It's mostly a first aid issue. And I do occasionally deal with the kindergartners through third graders. If there's something that the nurse can't handle orthopedic-wise, I'll go and I'll evaluate an elbow or a knee, depending on what they need. So at the upper school level, we have 400 students, and about 250 of them are student-athletes or my patients. We're pretty loaded up in the fall and spring at Viewpoint as far as sports are concerned. Winter's also busy because there's so many different levels of soccer and so many different levels of basketball for both boys and girls. So my pre-DAT philosophy, like I said, everything I learned was during my bachelor's level. I didn't really change after that. So a lot of it was therapeutic rehab based. I was very much into the Gary Gray three-plane, multi-planar exercises. So I spent a lot of time, I took a lot of pride in creating a 2, 4, and 6 week rehab protocol to, you know, get my patients better. If someone sprained an ankle or had patellar tendonitis, what I would do is I would go ahead and, you know, here's a 2 week program, a strengthening program, and there we go. Hopefully you're gonna get better. Hopefully, right? Crossing my fingers and praying for the best. One of my only philosophies that I actually had, because I didn't really think about having a philosophy at this point, was my low back pain philosophy. And I was very much into the Watkins-Rando protocol, which is a progressive, it's a stage-wise progression of multiple exercises for that go very easy to pretty hard, and it's a low back core stabilization program. And that was pretty much where, like, my bread and butter was. I was like, okay, I'm going to create this, you know, 4 to 6 week program that consisted of 20 visits, 25 visits, and using that. I was also problem-based. I like to do those evaluations. What that meant is, like, if someone had a shoulder issue, I would, you know what, let me look just beyond the shoulder a little bit. I wouldn't look, you know, all the way down the opposite hip or anything like that, but I'm like, you know, let me look in the neck maybe and see what's going on there. So I try to find other spots of where the pain or problems are coming from, not just treating the pain. The biggest thing is, again, I didn't learn anything new. I had a lack of clinical tools. I didn't know any manual therapies at this point. I literally exercised what I did, and I prescribed it, and I slapped an ice bag on things, and that's how I did it. And unfortunately, a lot of the techniques I did were not really backed by clinical evidence. And one of the biggest examples is rice. Right, so we're all taught like rice, rest, ice, compression, elevation. That's like the big one. Well, I think it was Dr. Merkin is his name. He's the one who coined this, rice. And he actually came back and said, like, he said this a couple years ago, like, that's the worst thing I could have did for healthcare. Like, that actually delays the healing process, the rest and the ice. He goes, there's ice is beneficial at some points, but not throughout the 6 weeks of the healing process, because it delays. But yeah, I was big on cryotherapy, cryokinetics. You know, I'd like to put my patient's foot in an ice bucket and then have them do some ice squats and things like that. I was big on ischemic release. You know, I like to get in there with my knuckles or my elbow and really poke around. And hopefully I can get that trigger point to release by pushing hard enough. I was big on that. Again, not really backed by clinical evidence. And I didn't really use the E-stim much. I'm not a fan of it. So even pre-DHA, I wasn't a fan of E-stim. I just felt, hey, there's better things I can do with rehab exercises. And I didn't really heat either. Like I said, I was big on ice and throw ice on everything, but I didn't really use a heat pack to get a patient. Perhaps the biggest thing, though, is both my philosophy and my clinical practice. I had no plan to get better. I thought I was good. I thought I was doing the right thing. I had no idea. I had no idea how to make myself better, how to take continuing education courses. I was just lost. I was going through the motions for 2 or 3 years, 4 years before I joined this athletic training program. So summer one of the DAT. So what the DAT does is you go to University of Idaho campus in Moscow over the summer. You spend about 5 weeks there. Day one was crazy. Like, they literally sat you down and said, everything you know is wrong, or you're taught incorrectly, and my whole world was flipped upside down. Like, I literally sat there, I was like, oh my God, what am I doing here? This is nuts. Like, imagine someone telling you, like, your whole belief system is incorrect at your profession, let alone that, you know? It was crazy. So, there's a lot of truth in the expression that you don't know what you don't know. I was ignorant to a lot of things, a lot of these manual therapy programs or paradigms that I was going to learn over the next 5 weeks. Like, I had no idea of some of these things. I was like, wow. And it was pretty much a re-education those first couple days, like really trying to beat a dead horse and get all the bad habits out of you. So like I said, immersion, we were there for 5 weeks. Sometimes we were there 6, 7 days a week for 4, 5, even 8 hours a day. So I was there for 5 weeks for a total about 300 hours. It was crazy. It was nonstop. I was definitely not the same clinician after. So, you know, we wrote reflections of this. Day one, who I felt as a clinician. And we wrote reflections about this, you know, day 30 or whatever, day 35. And, you know, I'm looking at the two, and I definitely wasn't the same. I had a new outlook, a new perspective on athletic training. I began to think about all the changes I was going to make in my clinical practice. Especially after this first summer, going into fall one, I had no idea what I was gonna do, and then I started coming up with these plans. So a lot of this was done by the introduction of new paradigms, new evaluation techniques, new philosophies, and these were given through class lab sessions, peer or professor presentations, and these weekend immersion courses. So we would have like a whole Con Ed weekend where positional release therapy, the guy who created it, he'd actually come to University of Idaho, and he spent 2 days with us, about 16 hours, learning one technique. It was crazy. It was awesome. And lack of a better term, it was an athletic training boot camp. It was like cognitive reconditioning. Like, listen, you have to start thinking about your whole clinical practice in a completely different way and forget everything you knew about athletic training and pretty much just start over with the most recent evidence to date that's the best possible stuff you can use. So my post-athletic training, my post-DAT philosophy. Like I said, I started thinking about everything I was going to do in my clinical practice, all these changes that I was going to incorporate. I had a completely new clinical philosophy. Both my rehab philosophy, my low back pain philosophy, my neck, like I had philosophies for every part of the body and how I thought I was going to treat patients from now on. And again, I went from very exercise-based, wanting to do all these rehab programs, to manual therapy-based, because I literally, that first summer, I learned a dozen new manual therapy paradigms. Probably three of them were weekend courses where I had 15, 16 hours in each one. I took a patient-oriented approach. What that means is when the patient comes in, I'm asking them questions. I'm trying to tailor my healthcare towards their needs and their specific impairment instead of, oh, your patient A is coming in and they have this issue. Patient B has the exact same issue. I'm going to treat both the same. So everything was very individualized and geared towards each patient. And I did that through a regional interdependent approach. And I'm sure you might have probably heard about this or maybe even heard something like this where, so regional interdependence is the actual problem or cause of pain is actually not directly, it's actually indirectly related to the area of pain. So if someone comes in with a shoulder issue and they're saying, my shoulder's starting to hurt, it's been hurting for 6 weeks from throwing, well, let's maybe like look at the left hip, or let's maybe look at the left knee, or I mean, let's even look at the neck. Let's look away from the side of pain. Okay, so we learned different evaluation techniques to do this. And then I also became very treatment-based classified, and that's kind of where you can do sub-therapeutic doses to see if this treatment's actually going to work for that patient. So you don't have to do a full treatment. It's just like, hey, let's tease it out a little bit and see if this might fix it. And if it does, then I can classify my patients now based on my treatments. Again, so treating the driver, not chasing the pain. And everything I learned was introduced over the summer and is responsible for my philosophy that changed then and is continually changing and evolving now. And one of the ways I was able to kind of reflect on all this change was the use of patient-reported outcomes. And that drove my clinical practice, and those are also PROs for short. And we'll get into PROs in a second, but just to kind of quickly go over it, it's a survey or an inventory you give to a patient and they give you some answers about how they're feeling. So you're actually saying, hey, patient A, please let me know how you're feeling. And they can go and you can actually track over time and give them the same form over and over to actually record progress. So all these new tools, new me, new practice, bye-bye, rest and ice. So these are some of the new tools I've learned, new paradigms, new treatments. Total motion release, molding concept, positional release therapy, primal reflex reset technique, neurodynamics, reflexive neuromuscular stabilization, the myokinesthetic system, energy medicine, the selective functional movement assessment, breathing assessment, and applied kinesiology. These are just a few of them. There's a couple more, but these are pretty much my bread and butter and my repertoire. So now what? Where do I go from here? So now that I have all these treatments and I get to use them, how do I know if they actually work for me, for my clinical practice, or patient A that comes in with a shoulder issue? How do I know if Mulligan is the right technique or TMR is the right technique? So patient-reported outcome, it subjectively records the patient's feeling towards their injury. And because it's something they're telling you, it's more meaningful and more accurate of how the patient actually feels. And it's scored on by a number system. So it's actual quantitative data that you can track throughout the progress. And I'll give you guys an example, one that's very common in a second. So the PROs, they're very good for us to use because they allow me to reflect and appraise the new treatments that I just got the hang of to see if they're actually working. Because anecdotal evidence is great. I treat patient A, he says, man, that stuff you did in my shoulder feels really, really good. He can tell me it feels really good, but do I have any justifiable evidence to that? No. So by me giving these PROs, I now have backed up evidence of actual quantitative data that I can say, hey, it actually didn't work. So that allows me to reflect on everything, allows me to move forward, allows me to say, hey, maybe this treatment wasn't the best for this patient, or maybe I should do something else. So it's kind of impossible to grow as a clinician and as an athletic trainer without at least getting into some sort of PRO. So the types of PROs. there's very global based PR. One of the most popular ones right now is the DPA scale, or the Disabled and the Physically Active. It's about 32 questions, and it has different things, and it's on a graded scale of 1 to 5. One that's very common, the numeric pain rating scale. I'm sure we're all familiar with this. We've probably never heard it called this before. But when you come in and a patient says, or someone asks you, your pain, give me your pain from a 0 to 10. 10, no pain at all, 10. Or 0 being no pain at all, 10 being worst pain imaginable you've ever experienced. So that's one of the most common ones, 0 to 10. And we can actually track that and continue to give that over time. Then we also have our PSFS and our CSIM. Those are very specific towards the patient. So I say, hey, you're a soccer player. How do you feel when you're trying to kick a ball? 10, they're completely able to kick the ball. 0, they're not. So they'll give you a score, too, on how they feel that they can actually perform that sport or perform a motion or perform an action. And that's also graded 0 to 10. Then you have your injury or location-specific ones. So we have our foot-ankle mobility measure. So say a patient of mine rolled their ankle, and I want to go ahead and give them, you know, a DPA scale, an NPRS, and maybe a CSIM, but I'm also probably going to give them the FAAM. What that does is ask specific questions about the ankle. They'll say, how do you feel cutting? And of course, when they first sprain it, they're going to score that very poorly. But as you go up through the rehab protocol or the treatment intervention, they're going to say, oh, well, things are getting better, and you're going to be able to see from treatment 1 to treatment 5 that you're getting progress. And there's more than just the anterior knee pain scale and the shoulder pain disability index. There's many more. There's the wrist-specific ones. There's low back-specific. There's even stress and fear-specific ones. So that, like I said, those are just a few. There's many, many more. Now that we have these outcomes and we're getting these PROs, we're using these to detect change over time over the course of a treatment. So what do we call that change? That change is called the Minimal Clinically Important Difference, or the MCID. Now, each scale is given an MCID, and that number was derived through statistical analysis of how the patient has undergone change. So, for example, the NPRS, you come in with a low back injury, and you're like, man, it's a 7 out of 10 right now, it really hurts, okay? So, pre-treatment, it's a 7 out of 10, we go ahead and do the treatment for you. Say post-treatment, I give you the exact same scale again, please rate it to me. Now you rate it a 4. So you went from a 7 to a 4. Well, with the NPRS, that MCID is a score of 2. So you actually have a change of 3 now. So we only, not only did we meet, but we also exceeded that MCID. That's actually meaningful. That change of 3 points that you had from your low back pain is actually meaningful to us. It's meaningful to research, meaningful to me, meaningful to you. Because I'm sure you've all gone to the doctor or you've all like tried to do something where you're a 7 out of 10 and after the treatment you're like, it's a 6.5 maybe, like didn't really change anything. That's not meaningful. But like if you went from a 7 to a 4, that's something that you can relate to and say, hey, that's actual detectable change. I feel that. I'm writing this down and I'm sharing that with someone and saying, this is actual evidence of saying I got better, as opposed to 6.5, you know. So, now what? Now that I have all these philosophies, these treatment paradigms, I'm using PROs in my clinical practice, what do I do now? I have to put this all into a plan. And it's impossible to give every patient that walks into my clinic a PRO. It's just, there's not enough time in the world to do all this. It's a waste of time. It's a waste of resources. But what you can do is you can study a local problem, an action research problem in your clinical practice. So I've noticed that, hey, my lateral ankle sprain patients aren't getting any better. I want to study that. I want to come up with a plan, a framework, or a workbook for myself at how to study that. And that's called an a priori design. So all my lateral ankle sprain patients, I'm going to kind of do something very similar. I'm going to give them all the same PROs, and now I'm going to do the exact same treatment. So not only am I doing one treatment to one patient, but I'm doing it to multiple patients. I'm going to see, is this actually working for a group of people, a problem in my clinical practice? Because I was not okay with my grade 1 ankle sprain patients taking 2 weeks to get better. I was not okay with that. You know, they were still playing, or maybe they weren't, but how can I make that better? So I created an a priori design on how to get that better. And I also had other little A priorities for a shoulder, a knee. I looked at those, I still studied them. But I had a goal every semester of a certain group of patients to look at. And I'm still treating every patient that walked in. So just because a patient walks in and I don't want to give them a PRO doesn't mean I'm not going to treat them. It's, again, it's my job, my duty to treat a patient. Just because I don't want to give them a PRO doesn't matter. I'm still going to treat them, try to get them better. Anecdotal evidence works sometimes. And sometimes it's kind of like a light bulb that says, oh, hey, maybe I should try this as a new priority next semester. So what drives my research, and I kind of mentioned action research a little bit. And action research is just finding a local problem in your clinical practice, whether it's your problem or a problem like throughout other colleagues in other schools, and going that way. So again, I found a local problem each semester, and I kind of studied that local problem. And I went semester through semester, growing, reflecting, changing. So this looks like a lot right now, and I'll break this down in a second much, much more easier. It's all notes and connotations that I've done for myself. So fall one, this is my first semester where I'm actually getting to try all these things, everything I knew, threw out the window, new DAT philosophy. And again, so break this down really quick, we're all gonna go like this. My patient ID number, the chief complaint, so LAS, lateral ankle sprain, my tendinopathy patients, and this is just, these abbreviations, SLS, that's just different types of testing for the neurological system. Then the treatments I use, the Mulligan, or did I use the Mulligan in the TMR, right? Sometimes I had combo treatments or singular treatments and just went that way. Then I had the total number of visits for my patients, their initial numeric pain rating scale, so they're 0 out of 10. So before I even did first treatment, what were they at? So 7 out of 10. And when I discharged them after 5 treatments, what were they at? They were at a 0. So for me, that was a positive outcome. So I'll go ahead and break that down right here. So fall one, I had a total N of 16. I saw many more patients than that, but that's the actual number of patients I actually collected data on. So my average number of visits for those 16 patients was 3.5. So a lot of these new techniques were robust. They're super effective. Sometimes it's just a quick little tweak of the joint and a patient feels better and they're like, oh man, I had that for 2 weeks and it's gone. You know, maybe I just kind of sped everything up a little bit or just fixed a tweak. Where my pre-DAT average was 12.5, my average amount of patient visits. And I got that through kind of weeding through my patient care software and seeing what was the average amount of patient visits. So, lateral ankle sprain. Pre-DAT, about 17.5 visits to treat a patient from getting them either return to play or actually feeling even better. I mean, I don't know. I didn't have any data on that. I didn't have PROs at the time. So imagine 18 treatments or 18 visits to get a patient better with a lateral ankle sprain. It's a long time. I had people in ice buckets. I had people doing heel raises and squats in the ice bucket. And again, icing for 6 weeks or whatever, however long, 3 weeks, 18 visits was not conducive to healing. Well, my new average was 4. So patients were getting better much quicker. How did I do that? Well, learned this cool little technique called the Mulligan concept, and it's really crazy how quick you can kind of reset and re-centralize the joint of the ankle with someone sprains it. Literally, I've had cases where someone sprained it right then and there, and I treated. And in the past, I would have said, dang, you're going to be out for 2 weeks minimum. Like, good luck, I'm going to put you on some crutches today and probably think about taking you off the crutches in 2 or 3 days, where I would treat that patient right then and there with this Mulligan technique. And I would do the sets of 10, 3 sets of 10. And next thing you know, they could go ahead and weight bear and not have an antalgic or limp, not have a gait. So they'd be able to walk normally. And there is like, holy smokes, I could probably play. In some cases, yeah, I actually let the patient play. So kind of the same thing with my patellar tendinopathy. That's just an all-encompassing term where I didn't want to say, oh, you have a tendonitis, or you're having patellofemoral pain syndrome. I'm just calling it tendinopathy. Or my pre-DAT average, 25 visits. So someone that had, you know, patellar tendinitis, 25 visits, we don't know why, because again, I was like, all right, we're going to do this three-way planer. exercises, and we're gonna have a 6-week protocol on try to strengthen that and get you better. And it took forever. Where with my new DAT tricks, again, like the Mulligan or PRRT, 5 visits. That's like a 500% increase. And again, so my lateral ankle sprain patients, this was my A priority really quick, so I gave them a D pass in NPRS and FAAM. And again, all MCIDs were met or exceeded for those patients. Remember that MCID was that detectable change. So for example, NPRS, if they came in with a 7, they left with a 0. I met and exceeded. So spring 2, what I decided to look at for spring 2 was my medial tibial stress syndrome patients. So I decided to look at patients that came with shin splints. And again, my pre-DAT average was 20 visits. Again, I was ice cupping, I was having them do strengthening exercises. It took forever. Where with my new DAT techniques, 6.34 visits. And what I did there is I incorporated a little bit of neurodynamics, so nerve flossing. I actually looked at the sensory component, not just the mechanical component of shin splints, and treated the sensory component. And got great results. And I also kind of combo treated that with positional release therapy and primal reflex reset technique. So combo treating all those patients, not only did they not miss any practices, but they were better in 300% of the time. Fall 2, I collected a lot of patients, I think it was 29, and I wanted to focus my A priority on my low back pain patients. You know, during the fall, you get a lot of football weightlifters getting hurt, football players getting hurt, volleyball players, you know, when they come back, they have all that low back pain. So I decided to focus on that in the fall. And my pre-DAT average was 26 visits, and again, that goes back to my Watkins-Randall protocol, where I treat a patient for 6 weeks again, trying to get their core stability better, stronger, you know, their endurance up. Where I learned these other techniques, I learned energy medicine, how to clear chakras, and focus a lot of that on my low back patients. I also, another Mulligan concept technique for the low back I would do. So I had 5 low back pain patients for my A priority, and the average number of visits they were in was for 2. Some patients I got better on 1, and some patients took 3 or 4 visits. Spring 2, I have 18 patients, and I wanted to go ahead and look at my patients with neck issues. I've never done that before, and I was actually kind of always afraid to treat the neck as an athletic trainer prior to the DAT, because that's just a crazy area, and you don't want to, you know, knock someone unconscious or give them a stroke or anything like that. So I was always a little worried. So that's why I don't have any data pre-DAT. Because again, someone come in, I'm like, you know what, here's a nice pack, see you later. If it really hurts, go see your doctor. Well, what I was doing now is I was evaluating the neck much, much more thoroughly. And my patients, I was getting a better probably 1.5 to 2 treatments. So they'd come in, I'd evaluate the neck, and then I'd do a Mulligan concept technique, I'd do a primal reflex reset technique, or even a positional release technique. Do one of those three, and that was like my bread and butter for the neck. And again, my 4 patients and the PROs, the MCIDs for those were all met. Fall 3, decided to look at the low back again, because I learned some new techniques, especially energy medicine, learned some different things, and I wanted to kind of focus on that and go that way. So again, my pre-DAT average is 26, and I told them because I was doing that Watkins protocol, low back stabilization, and my average number of visits is 3. Spring 3. I wanted to focus on GH pain, whether it was a sprain, a strain, a contusion, anything going on in the shoulder. I wanted to look at my pre-DAT average number of visits was 14.5. And again, goes back to all the exercises I had him do, I's, Y's, and T's for days. Okay, let's add weight, do more of that. And the new techniques I was using the Mulligan concept, total motion release. I was also using energy medicine for that, some applied kinesiology. and I was able to knock that down to the average of 3 visits. So, impact of the DAT. I went through my 3 years right there, just like that. What does that mean for me? So, I felt that I became a more advanced scholarly practitioner in athletic training. What does that mean, advanced scholarly? Well, I was understanding the research. I was doing my own research. I was looking at the research, dissecting and disseminating. But I was also doing my own. Not only was I doing that, not only was I just a researcher, I was also a practitioner as well. So it's kind of do as you preach. So again, improved appraisal of the research, improved researching skills, it improved my clinical practice, and I had confidence in myself and my starting five. And I'll go over my starting five in a second. Clinical site improvement, I improved my patient reported outcomes, I improved my standard of care, my assessments and my treatments were much, much better. I gained confidence of many more individuals. So everyone kind of always liked me and thought I was doing a good job at my site, but the coaches, patients, the parents of the patients, and the admin, they were like, wow, we can actually see this change. And I actually said, well, actually, I have documented evidence of this change too. So it's great. My attending clinician, very much like me, went to the same program, and we were also all rehab-based, spent a lot of time doing the six-week protocols. So I improved his skills, too, by discussion, teaching him, giving a hands-on approach, and other AT colleagues as well said, hey, tell me more about this DAT. So tell me more about these paradigms you're doing. How are you improving your patient care? Like, what's a PRO? So my starting five, this is something I kind of like created myself by going through and reflecting. What do I mean by that? So this is a basketball analogy. In the past 3 years, I've wanted to come up with a take-home message of what I could tell people about my clinical practice. And I'm confident that my starting five can treat 90% of the patients I see in under 5 visits. The other 10%, sometimes they might need a bench player treatment to kind of come in and treat that. Maybe it might take more visits. But again, my starting five can treat 90% of the patients I see in 5 visits. So just like any good basketball team, the starting five rotation is subject to change, all depending on the opponent, the scheme, slumps, and free agency pickups in the offseason. So if I take a new Con Ed course over the summer, we'll go from there. And again, every good basketball team always has to have a good six-man that's going to come off the bench and be ready to play no matter what. So my starting five, as of a couple of days ago. Total motion release, Mulligan concept, positional release therapy, primal reflex reset technique, and neuromuscular stabilization. That's my starting five. This has changed and rotated throughout the last 3 years, but as of now, these are my starters. This is my bread and butter. With these guys, I can tackle just about any patient that comes into my clinic. My sixth man, neurodynamics. Neurodynamics and energy medicine have kind of gone back and forth. That's my sixth man, but right now it's definitely neurodynamics. And the rest of my bench, I mentioned those before, the mild kinesthetic system, applied kinesiology, and I have these two asterisks because they're not really a treatment, it's more of an assessment. But sometimes when I have a patient that's kind of giving me issues, I'll go put them in the SFMA or a breathing assessment, and I'll kind of come back and go and use my starting five to treat. Future growth. So I want to definitely finish my post-curricular manuscripts. I want to continue to submit manuscripts for publication. I want to continue my TMR study that we started. My paradigms, my treatment paradigms, I want to continue to hone the skills. I want to take more courses in the Ewan method, applied kinesiology, and fascial movement taping. I want to seek out certifications in PRT and the Mulligan concept. I want to continue to grow. I want to continue to reflect about my clinical practice. I'm going to continue to use PROs to drive anything new that I learn or any new problem that I might come up with in my clinical practice. Now, perhaps one of the biggest take-home messages of the athletic training program is the dissemination of knowledge. I share that philosophy. So how are we going to share this knowledge? Through symposium presentations, through manuscripts, through blogs, through peer presentations, whether it's with colleagues on one-on-one or small group in-services, and continue to have casual but scholarly conversations with other medical professionals. And I have this asterisk. This is like a future growth of mine. I'd like to be on a post-professional development committee for whether it's a local or regional association. I'd like to do that and kind of share what I know and share my knowledge with others and kind of give them an area to go. Any questions? I know that was a lot.
Wait, I have a question. Out of all the doctorate programs around here, why did you pick University of Medicine?
Well, great part, one of the reasons why I picked it is you're able to kind of still continue your clinical practice. I didn't have to, you know, drop out of my work for 2 years to go do a doctorate program. You know, that was one of the things I didn't want to do. So I was able to work and continue to get better as an athletic trainer. One of the main reasons why is this program, it's not just, oh, hey, you're going to go get your doctorate in biomechanics and learn how to study a drop landing. Like, that's not going to make me a better athletic trainer. It's going to make me more money, maybe, at the university level, but it's going to make me a better athletic trainer. Continuing to study my clinical practice and get tools and insight and improve my clinical practice. That's why I picked that program.
And you said you have your starting five. Is there a go-to, like
you know,
top player?
lately, I've been kind of using the one-minute exam of PRRT, and it's, you lay the patient down, and you just go through, and you can palpate a bunch of different muscles, and you can feel tissue density changes. And in that quick one-minute exam, there's treatments for all of us. So you figure what are the spots that are like lighting you up, mm-hmm. and you can go in and treat those spots. And go from there. That's one of my favorite ones. Also, the reset techniques where you chop the karate chopping. And I also really like TMR. TMR is so great because you can break apart the system. It's six exercises. You can break it apart in just one or two and quick treat a patient that way. Or you can put them through the whole assessment of all six exercises and treat them from their worst one to their best one. Those are my two favorite ones.
Do you feel like your coworker has improved with working with you as you're going through this?
I'm going to say my coworker's improved by just seeing what I'm doing and seeing the results that I've gotten. He's able to do a Mulligan technique for the knee, the internal rotation of the knee, and he's able to get the patient better, you know, maybe one or two treatments. But I don't think he's reflecting on it in a meaningful way like I do. I think he's just like, oh, I saw Miguel do this for the knee, let me do this. Now, that might work for that patient, but it might not work for a patient that comes in a couple days later, you know? So where I have, like, different ideas of what I can do for someone with that, I don't think he has because he hasn't reflected. But, yeah, he's gotten better.
Do you feel like you use a blend of your old practice with the new?
No.
Or do you think it's a completely
different
practice?
I think, like anything, whether it's a relationship with someone or you're building something, everything starts with a good foundation. And as much as I was like, man, why didn't I learn all of these things in my entry-level program at the bachelor's level? Why didn't I learn any of this? But now, when I actually reflect on it, like, you know what? All that foundational knowledge is very important and gives me a place to kind of build the rest of my athletic. That's still filming.
Yeah.
Perfect. All right. So I think I still blend both very well. There are some things I've completely abandoned, like the ice and all of that, to a certain extent. But I think, it's important to blend the two. I haven't just completely did all that.
When do you use ice and when do you not use ice? Do you just...
I like to use ice in the first 48 hours of my patient care. So if I see them immediately, I like to ice immediately, kind of calm all that down. But anything after 48 hours is just kind of, you're delaying the injury, you're delaying the healing process, the inflammatory process.
Well, you said earlier you didn't use heat, you use heat now?
You know what, yeah, because one of the big things, especially with positional release therapy, the PRT, I noticed sometimes, I'm just trying to like buy myself some time because I have a lot of patients, I'll put heat on a patient, and I've noticed that I've actually been getting better results with the PRT after they're already kind of warm because it helps the circulation of all of those superficial surfaces. That's it? Cool.
Good job.